Welcome to NewPointe. Wherever and however you're joining us, we are so excited today. At NewPointe, we like to focus on three vital relationships: connect with God, connect with others, and connect others to God. We believe that life is complicated right now, and we want you to know that we can help. And that's through three resources that we've created. The first one is our app. If you haven't downloaded our app yet, hop over to the App Store and download that now. The second thing is our YouTube channel. Make sure when you hop onto YouTube, you subscribe to us so you can get instant access to all of the content in today's message. And the third thing is our website, which is newpointe.org. You're gonna get old messages, you're gonna get all kinds of resources, and while you're there, check out newpointe.org/lifeiscomplicated, and that's gonna have all kinds of resources to help you and your family during this difficult time. In today's experience, it's gonna be less than an hour. We're gonna have music, we're gonna have a message, and we're gonna have an interview. We believe that this is going to be life-changing. So gather everyone around, because we're about to get started.
Love me, leave me, rhythm of the evening, chasing a good time. London's burning, if the world is ending, let's stay up all night. Do you remember what you said to me? 'Cause we lost track of time, yeah, we lost track of time. You always let me down so tenderly. So live fast and die young, and stay forever numb. You said that maybe this is where it ends. Take a bow.
Take a bow for the bad decisions that we made. Bad decisions that we made. Hey everyone, welcome to our weekend service here at NewPointe. My name is Bree.
And I'm Joel, and I'm so glad you joined us today. Our service this week is gonna be focused on decision making and how we can best make wise decisions that ultimately honor God.
Now that you're watching with us today, we know that you've made at least one decision, and we wanna thank you for choosing to watch with us. But I can guarantee that's not the only decision that you'll make today.
So Bree, if you had to guess, how many decisions do you think that we make on average every single day?
I think at least 800. But my theory is that if you're a parent, you probably make at least double the decisions than that because you're managing little lives, right?
Right, right. Well, surprisingly, scientists say that kids make 3,000 decisions every single day and that adults, 35,000 decisions. And the best part, 227 of those are on, guess what? Food.
I love it. Those are things that are so small that we don't even really think about it. Decisions like what I'm gonna eat, what time I'm gonna get up in the morning, or even what I'm gonna wear to work. Then, of course, there are some things that are bigger, right? Like maybe buying a new house or switching careers potentially, and even voting for the next president that we're all thinking about right now.
Yeah, you know, regardless of the size, all decisions impact us in some way. So today, our lead pastor, Dwight, is gonna unpack how we can best make decisions possible, even when it seems like there's none to be made.
You can expect our service to be about an hour long and include Dwight's message, some songs from our team, and a story of life change from Kevin West at our Dover campus.
Right now, though, we want to share with you Jonathan Wood's conversation with Sarah Anderson. Sarah is a Christian leader and author of the book, The Space Between Us, How Jesus Teaches Us to Live Together When Politics and Religion Pull Us Apart.
I think that title kind of says it all. They're gonna cover a lot of ground in this conversation, and there's definitely something for everyone, especially during this complicated time. Let's take a look.
So, Sarah, you grew up in Washington, D.C., known by many as the Swamp, right? I mean,
yes.
The Washington, D.C. with politics and everything. Your father, yes. Gary Bauer, he ran for president in 2000. You've definitely had some exposure to politics and how it works in the family dynamic. And you've written a book kind of about this that's called The Space Between Us. Was there an event or something that led to you wanting to write this book?
I think I probably was like a lot of people and noticed in the past couple of years that the dialogue around politics was getting more and more toxic. I didn't consider myself an expert in politics by any stretch of the imagination, but having come from a political family, my dad having the experience that he had, and my brother and my sister both went into politics, have worked for congressmen, senators, governors, vice president, State Department. I'm like in it. Maybe someone else is more equipped to write this, but I thought our politicians aren't really leading out in this conversation. So maybe it needs to be someone, just any citizen really, that can take this conversation and begin to lead out in it and set an example. And so I thought, you know, why not me? Why not any human that wants to talk in a more humane way to people? Any of us can do that. And I'm a mom. I have an 8-year-old and I have a 10-year-old. And the last presidential election, I could tell that they were just starting to be much more aware of the conversations happening on news stations, around the dinner table, noticing signs and bumper stickers. And I thought, this is a problem. I don't want them to think that politics has to be this way. Even if I'm just acknowledging the problem, I'm complicit in it if I'm not doing anything to help solve it. And so I just thought, why not bring my experience and just what I've learned from my own family and see if that could be helpful to other people.
That's great. And the book is fantastic. You know, we are in an election year, as you know, and so election years in the United States are obviously always very tense. For you, your dad, he ran for president. What is it like being the daughter of somebody running for a high office?
The short answer was I was not a fan, but that was probably because I was a senior in high school and I thought everything should have been about me at that point. And that obviously when your dad runs for president, that changes things. The experience itself, you know, we had a lot of great memories that came from that, traveling around the country and going to presidential debates. But the actual political side was very challenging, I would say, and for a couple of different reasons. The first one is in primary season, you know, we've seen this with the Democrats this year, and we saw it with the Democrats and Republicans last election. The conflict is really in-house. It's Republicans against Republicans and Democrats against Democrats until convention time, and then everybody's on the same team again. You grew up hearing the bad guys were the other side, but then during primary season, the bad guy is someone else who's supposed to be on your team. It really quickly made adversaries out of friends, it created such a divisive and kind of toxic environment in that way, where you felt like, gosh, I thought, and under any other circumstances, we'd be with each other. But right now we're not, we're fighting against each other. So that was hard. The other side of it is you really realize how little control you have over the narrative being told about you and your family. For most of my life, my dad was involved in politics and in the Reagan administration, had, you know, chief domestic policy advisor to the president. He was on the fringes of politics. We got all the perks, but none of the disadvantages. And then when he was running, he was in the spotlight enough where you just realize you have very little control over what's being said about you, or this one particular soundbite that's being used, or one picture that's being used. And I kept thinking, as he was growing in familiarity to the public, the feeling of being not known was growing as a family, that you didn't actually know who we were. You didn't know what made us a family, or, you know, those kinds of things that make a person a person. And so it really kind of made you feel that you were starting to become a two-dimensional image of a person more than a human being. That stayed with me. I try to remember that, you know, in every election season, that it is so easy to make someone the sum of their political decisions, but instead, you know, there's a human being behind them. They go home to families at night. They come from families. And remembering that very holistic image, I think, helps us preserve the humanity.
That's great. That's great. So how often then do you watch the news a week?
These days, not very often.
It's good. It's good.
I try to stay informed, but I think it's important, you know, for all of us to pay attention to emotional health, mental well-being. You know, sometimes it's just not helpful. Being informed matters. Participating in the civic process, that is the least that is required of us. The most that's required of us is engaging with the people after Election Day.
Yeah. Get the issues, find out the issues, and really try to research it from good balanced standpoint. I think this is great stuff, especially for people now. The book is The Space Between Us. Where can people find this book?
Yeah, it's on barnesandnoble.com and amazon.com. So you can find it both.
It's awesome. Sarah, thank you so much for taking the time, talking with us, and having this discussion.
Yes, thank you for having me.
Appreciate it.
us now be glorified.
Basically, I make people mad for a living. I'm a business coach. I do business coaching, executive coaching. Well, the biggest thing that brought us to Sugar Creek wasn't anything we would have expected it to be. There was a night when I was going to Taco Bell, and I was driving to Taco Bell, and I got to a stop sign, and I felt like God was saying to me, you know, your time here is done. And at that point, I had a number of things going on. I was an athletic director and a basketball coach, and had a basketball scouting service and basketball camps. I had all this stuff going on, and people thought we were joining a cult. So there were like all these people having these interventions with us and stuff, you know, what are you doing? And it really was a year later when really all of the doors kind of opened up. It led me to have a meeting with Dwight at Dutch Valley. He asked me, he said, you know, what do you want to do? You know, and I said, well, I don't know. I just want to make a difference. And he said, well, I want to change the world. And I said, I think I could sign up for that. The coming to Sugar Creek part of it, we fell to pieces about was when we got here is when we started freaking out. I don't know about you, but I know for me, you know, I want everything all figured out before I get there, and it wasn't. I had this picture, right? You know, we all have these pictures of things that we want to see happen the way we want them to happen, and the problem is we start trying to figure out what we need to do to make that happen. But the thing I bumped into, it wasn't about what I did, it was about what I believed. The way that I kind of had to figure that out is I had to kind of try to find some level of solitude and recommit myself to some very core practices. Not do a whole lot of asking when I pray, but just a whole lot of listening. And I started realizing when my beliefs started banging into the picture that God had more of a bigger plan for me than I did. The transition was probably one of the biggest challenges I've ever had in my life. Leaving NewPointe was really just around looking around and look at the organization and saying, hey, you know, it's time to transition. To leave a comfort zone of something that you know and enter into something that is very unknown. Was it uncertain? It was really uncertain. Was there a lot of fear? Absolutely, 100%, a lot of fear. Was there a sense of a purpose involved in that? Yeah, there was. I grew up in a house with an alcoholic father. I knew he loved me, but the expressions of that weren't there. I think there were always moments in those quiet times when I would be in my room, or I would be, you know, by myself, or I would try to process what was going on in our house, that I really felt that comfort. And I really couldn't describe it as a kid. I didn't really know exactly what that was. As I got older and understood that, I understood those were times where God was with me. You know, he was holding me. He was telling me it was gonna be okay. And I'm learning this at NewPointe. Everybody is somebody Jesus died for. And so in the context of my work, I started thinking like, well, you know, I can help people organizationally, and I can help people, you know, on a lot of levels, regardless of where they come from or who they've been or what experiences they've had.
there is something within all of us that void that only God can fit in. And everybody's spending their lives trying to find something to fill that with. It makes me passionate about trying to find ways to help them bump into Jesus in some small way. I didn't stop doing ministry, I just stopped doing church work. Do I really believe that God is who he says he is and what he will do what he's promised to do, right? I mean, that's the biggest thing. Do I really do that? Am I living on that level of faith? That's where the decisions really come into play. The decisions really are about opening your hands. The decisions are really about letting go and trusting. The decisions really are about not me, but you. Meet you wherever you are. And sometimes you got to lean into the fact that he's got a plan and his plan's bigger than whatever you thought of that you need or want. And that if you would just be obedient to whatever he's asking you to do, he will take you places you've never thought. There is something really, really big that God has in store for you. And there's a level of freedom that you're going to have to live in order to do the kind of damage that God's calling you to do.
Life is all about decision making, your selections, your decisions along with your responses to other people's decisions are really the only thing in life you can control, which means your decisions is the way in which you and I control our lives. You see, whether you like it or not, you are where you are today because of your decisions. Yeah. It's your fault. You have to take responsibility for that. And yet, if you're like most people, your greatest regrets are connected to the decisions that you've made. And what happens is this: we don't learn from our decisions, do we? Because we typically blame them on other people. We point our fingers. And our decisions, though, are heavily influenced by our emotions and by our appetites. Did you get that? You see, research tells us that we make decisions because of our emotions, that really we can't make decisions apart from our emotions. And our experiences confirm that our appetites are often in charge of us, and they overrule our intelligence. You see, here's what we have to come to, and that is this: our decisions have been shaped and directed the qualities of our life. Our decisions have been shaped, and they also determine the qualities of our life. You see, you and I never fully know what hangs in the balance of a decision. We just don't. We never fully know. Now, what we do know is the private decisions that you and I make have public implications. Your private decisions and my private decisions, guess what? They're not going to stay private. No way. Your personal decisions will no doubt impact and influence a large group of people, more than what you ever think. And now the biggest challenge is when you're making those decisions and you don't know the outcome. You're not for sure about how it's going to affect you and those around you. You see, no one plans on complicating their life with wrong decisions or poor decisions or bad decisions. None of us do. And so your decisions are huge. They're huge. Now, what I want to do is I want to share with you some questions that I've learned from Andy Stanley. He just wrote a book, and it's called Better Decisions, Fewer Regrets. And it's an important book for every person to read. So I want to encourage you to buy that book, because it's just one of the best books I've read. And what it does is it gives us a grid to make decisions in all areas of life. And there's nothing more important than learning how to make good decisions. And so I want to give you those five questions. The first question is the question of integrity. The question of integrity. This is so important. And you might say, why? Because you and I can convince ourselves of anything. Isn't that right? Absolutely. You've talked yourself in many decisions because of the emotions and because of the appetites. It's called confirmation bias. And that's where the tendency happens in your life and in my life to look for evidence and confirmations of the existing beliefs and theories that we possess. We look for information or arguments to support what we've already decided and what we've already believed and planned to do. And we see what we want to see, right? We hear what we want to hear. We believe what we want to believe. And anything contrary to that, you know what we do? We just tune it out. We just push it aside. Don't believe me? Remember the last time you were looking to buy a car? You saw that same model everywhere. And you're thinking in your mind, you know what? Must be God. Must be God. He wants me to get this car. I'm seeing it everywhere. And your brain was tuned in to identify it. And it happens almost with everything in life. You find what you're looking for, and then you believe that that's what you need. And you need to be aware of that. I need to be aware of that. You see, when we talk to ourselves, we talk ourselves into doing things and buying things and making decisions out of our emotions and out of our appetites. And we pay. And sometimes we pay dearly because they affect our future. And some of us are still reaping from some of those decisions. And maybe you'll just pay for that the rest of your life. And don't you know they come up at the most opportune times where you don't want them to come up, I don't want them to come up, things that you wish you could go back and change, things that you wish you could go back and talk yourself out of, maybe that bad purchase, maybe that car, or maybe that boat, or the time you got a DUI, okay, or maybe that bad relationship, that marriage, or that business partner that you chose, or those bad habits that you're fighting right now, or that addiction. They all came through making choices. And so the question that we have to ask in this is this: am I being honest with myself in making this decision? Really being honest. Am I really being honest about this decision? Do I have integrity? Proverbs says it like this: the one who walks in integrity will experience a fearless confidence in life. Wow. You want that? But the one who is deceivious will eventually be exposed. You see, there's a difference between being dishonest and deceitful. You see, dishonest is much more easier to detect because when we're deceived, it's a mixture of what? Half-truths. And so we must ask ourselves this question: am I being honest with myself? Really being honest. And so we need to make a decision. And here's the decision we need to make. I will not lie to myself, even though the truth makes me feel bad about myself. It's the integrity question. Here's the second question, and it is this. It's the legacy question. The legacy question. Every decision that you make becomes a permanent part of your story, the story of your life. Every decision that you make has an outcome. Every decision that you make and I make has a consequence. And the outcome and the consequences are the things that you and I don't predict. We didn't think it was going to happen that way. Yet they become a part of our permanent story. And so when you and I are making a decision, we need to press pause. And we need to ask this question: what story do I want to be able to tell? To tell my spouse, to tell my kids, to tell my friends. You see, it's easy for you and I to lose sight of the bigger picture. Would you agree with me? We can give in, and I can give in to the pressure of the moment or the temptation of the moment. And when you and I are forced to make a decision under pressure, it's hard to think about the future. When you and I are tempted to do something, it's hard to think about the future, isn't it? And this complicates the decision-making process. Because we have a tendency to focus on the immediate, the now, rather than the future. And usually this because is of a strong emotion and an appetite appeal that dwells in you and dwells in me. It plays to our emotions. And our experiences confirm this over and over again, that we are people who make decisions out of our emotions and out of our appetites, even over our intelligence. And so we think of the now, and we don't think about the future. And when I look back on this decision, I have to ask, which of the options do I really want to choose? Because it's going to be a part of my life story. And so what story do I want to write and tell? Paul says it like this. He says, follow my example as I follow the example of Christ. And so I have to say, would I want somebody to follow this example? Would I want to really tell this story if I'm going to make this decision? And so what we have to think about is this. I'm writing a story. You're writing a story. Picture yourself 10 years from now. Is that the story that you want to be able to tell? Are you headed in the right direction? And so we have to make a decision again. And here's the decision that we need to make. I will write a story I'm proud to tell, one decision at a time. Here's the third question that we need to process, and that is conscience. Okay? Usually, when we're in the process of making a decision, I know I am, okay? There is tension that rises up inside of me, and we feel it, right? There's something about it that maybe doesn't seem completely right. It's not that it's wrong, there's just a level of where maybe you're not completely comfortable. There's something about it that bothers you, and it causes you to what? Hesitate. It's not a no, and yet there may be some uneasiness there. And you have to pay attention to it. You can't blow it off. If you do, you probably won't make the best decision. And so here's the question that I have to ask. Is there a tension that deserves my attention? Is there a tension that deserves my attention? And so what happens is I come back to my conscience. What does my conscience say? Luke writes this, and he records it from Paul. So I strive always to keep my conscience clear before God and man. Wow. You see, that's how we make decisions. We want to keep a clear conscience before man and before God. And so here's the decision that we need to make. We need to make it prior to any decisions that we make. I will explore rather than ignore my conscience. When I feel that twitch inside, I'm not going to just discard it. I'm going to ask deeper questions. Now, these three questions, okay, are a little bit uncomfortable. Would you agree with me? But you know what? They are worth asking. And I truly believe that they will help you, they will help me to live a life with fewer and fewer regrets. Let me give you the fourth one. The fourth one is maturity. The question of maturity. One of the problems we face often in making decisions is based on the question that only focuses on the broadest or the most widely applicable requirement. That being, okay, we ask questions like this. Is it morally wrong? Is it morally wrong? And we continue to ask questions like this, okay? Is there anything wrong with it? Could I get away with this? Is it legal? And we assume that if there's nothing morally or legally wrong with it, it's a decision that I can say yes to. I can say it's okay and I can move in that direction. And yet if you're a follower of Christ today, we want our lives to be defined by wisdom. We want to be able to make wise choices. And so here's the question. What is the wise thing to do? What is the wise thing to do? Not is it right or is it wrong? What is the wise thing to do? You see, asking what is the wise thing to do is a natural outpouring of something I'm already trying to accomplish. But whether you are religious or not, the question is still very, very valid. You see, you respond to life's decisions based on whatever your worldview is. And no matter what your worldview is, all of us want to make good decisions. And so it can and should be asked, okay? And it's not exclusively a spiritual concept. What makes this so wise? What makes this question so powerful is what it does for you and what it does for me. And we end up being less emotional about the decision. We end up being less focused on relationship issues. We end up being less controlled by our own selfishness and greed, less controlled by those things around us. We're less able to rationalize our decisions. And you see, all of these issues you and I face in the process of making decisions. And so the question is very much worthwhile to ask because it diminishes all of those issues. You see, to really gain clarity on making good decisions, we have to dig deeper with the question. And we have to look at it from three different angles. And Andy talks about this in his book. And here's what he says. Ask yourself this. In light of my past experiences, my current circumstances, and my future hopes and dreams, what is the wisest thing for me to do? Now, Paul writes to a group of people in Ephesus, and here's what he would say. Be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as what? Wise. Asking that question, what is the wise thing to do? Making the most of every opportunity because the days are evil. Therefore, he says, do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. And so we have to ask the question, what is the wise thing to do? And we have to make this decision in our heart. I will take the past, the present, and the future into consideration when I make this decision. It's not just going to be a now. Let me give you the fifth and final one, and that is the relationship. The relationship. Now, this is a very dangerous question, okay? Because this will lead you beyond right and wrong. This question will lead you to consider things that most people would never, ever, ever entertain. This question might cost you some money, some time. It might even cost you a relationship. This could cost you your job. I know people who started spending less time at work and more time with their family when they ask this question. I know people who started spending less money and started giving more money away when they ask this question. I know people who have been hurt and betrayed and who have forgiven those people. Why? Because they know that God has forgiven them. And it's this, what does love require of me? What does love require of me? See, if you would talk to any of those people, they would tell you that it saved them from a life of bitterness and regret and resentment over something that they couldn't have changed anyways. And common sense would say, hang on to your hurt. Common sense would say, continue to tell your sad, 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 sad story. Use it to get back at them. Use it to hurt the people who hurt you. And yet there is power in this question, and it will provide uncomfortable clarity. And it's this, what does love require of me? What does love require of me? If you ask this question, what does love require of me? You will know the answer clearly, I promise you. Though it might be uncomfortable, it's an invitation for you and me to live a larger life than just ourselves. And if you're not intentional with your life, you'll never live the bigger life. You'll always live a small life. And so we have to come back and we have to ask, what does love require of me? You see, this is the question that Jesus asked. And Paul says this about Jesus. He says, in your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus. What was his mindset? What does love require of me? And it ensures you and I that we will not live a small life. You see, the way in which God loves you and me, we're called to love other people. We love God by loving other people. So what would be the most loving thing to do with the people around me? What would be the most loving thing for me to do in making this decision? Paul describes the mindset of Jesus with this. He says, be free from pride-filled opinions, for they will harm your cherished unity. Don't allow your self-promotion to hide in your hearts. But in authentic humility, put others first and view others more important than yourselves. Abandon every display of selfishness. possess a greater concern for what matters to others instead of your own interest. Wow. If we would ask that question, you know what? We would live with fewer regrets. And so we have to make this decision in our hearts. I will decide with the interests of others in mind. I will decide with the interests of others in mind. You see, I want you to begin to ask these five questions, especially between now and the end of the year. If you will, I promise you, you'll have less regrets. Imagine what could happen in your personal life, in your professional life. Imagine what could happen in your marriage. Imagine what could happen in your family. Imagine what could happen at work. Imagine what could happen in your relationship with God. Imagine how strong you could finish life with if we would just begin to ask these questions. Be unbelievable, wouldn't it? And so I encourage you to go back and begin to ask these questions, because you're making decisions. They're leading you somewhere. You see, life is all about making decisions. And the better decisions that you make, the less regrets you'll have in your life. And Jesus wants to help you with that. You see, Jesus makes life better, and he makes you and I better at life because he's willing to lead us and guide us. Would you pray with me? God, we thank you today for who you are. We love you. And we thank you that you've created us as free will people, that you give us choices. You allow us to make choices. But you also have said that you'll give us your wisdom. You'll lead us and you'll guide us and you'll direct us. And God, I believe for myself as well as all of us here today, if we would begin to use these five questions as a grid, we'd have fewer regrets in our life. We'd finish life stronger and more confident than ever before. And so, Jesus, we just want to invite you into the decision-making process, because we know that you only desire that which is good and that which is best for us. And you want us to live life and live life to the fullest. And we thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen.
I lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will. I'll bless your name. Oh, yes, I will. I'll sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh, yes, I
Thanks for that message, Dwight, and for those words we just heard from the band. Whether we like it or not, life is all about decision making. It's one of the only things that we can truly control. We've all made our fair share of good decisions and probably just as many bad ones too. Our prayer for you today is that you'd be able to accept the bad decisions that you've made, but not let them define you. We want to encourage you to pray that God would give you wisdom and discernment to make thoughtful decisions, and when you don't, grace to choose better next time. If you need prayer today, we'd like nothing more than to pray and encourage you on your walk with God. The best way you can do that is by going to newpointe.org. Just look at the intercom icon in the bottom right-hand corner of the page. We have staff members standing by to partner with you in prayer. Thank you so much for joining us in our service today. We can't wait to see you next week.